Greetings, my lovelies. This is Blake here, and welcome to my review of Batman vs. Superman Dawn of Justice. Now, there's been a lot of disappointment surrounding this movie because people's expectations were so, so high. After all, it's Batman vs. Superman. This should be the coolest movie ever. And yet, everyone seems kind of let down by it, and sometimes they outright hate this movie. So, what went wrong? Well, you should know that going into this, I had virtually no expectations. My excitement encountered stumbling block after stumbling block to where by the time it was released, I felt nothing. Problem number one was I did not have a positive reaction towards Man of Steel. I thought it was very mediocre, and I gave that movie two different shots, and each time I thought it was very forgettable and kind of dull. Problem number two was Zack Snyder, the director of Man of Steel, was attached to helm this movie, so the chance that this would be a step up from its predecessor had just been drastically reduced. Problem number three was this suffered from one of the most horrendous marketing campaigns ever. I actually enjoyed the teaser and even appreciated the first trailer on some level, even though both were very controversial, and I had some Man of Steel flashbacks in that these characters had the tendency to give these hokey speeches that I just cannot take seriously. And then the third trailer pretty much spoiled everything. That was bizarre and stupid. And the fourth trailer, I just didn't trust, even though it was well-liked by the majority of fans. To me, it seemed like they were trying to package it as one of the Marvel comic book movies, and it just didn't work. Like, you could make an argument that the Suicide Squad trailer was trying too hard to be like Guardians of the Galaxy, but at least there, the music, the tone, and the visuals had great chemistry together to where I could believe that that is an accurate representation of the film itself. With the Batman vs. Superman's fourth trailer, though, the upbeat music just did not mesh very well with the very dreary visuals, so it really seemed like they were misrepresenting what this film was going to be like. And that drew attention to how insecure this marketing campaign seemed, and that's disturbing considering how Batman vs. Superman is an idea that should sell itself, and yet they're resorting to spoilers and misleading the audience to sell their movie, which tells me that they know the film is not very good and are desperate to trick as many people as possible to see it in the opening weekend before the negative word comes out. And then the fourth problem was I think it was too early to put Batman and Superman together. Like, DC wants to build their own Avengers-styled universe surrounding the Justice League. Fine. But what made the Avengers so special was they had a bunch of solo movies building up to it. So when we finally get to see Captain America and Iron Man and Thor interact with each other, it means something. You are seeing franchises collide. And with Batman vs. Superman, it just feels like they're jumping the gun too early. At the absolute least, they needed a standalone Batman flick where we could see Ben Affleck's interpretation of this character. And therefore, when you finally get to see these two franchises collide, it will feel special. It will mean something. But now Batman just kind of feels like he's a part of Superman's universe, and it just kind of loses the novelty, in my opinion. And this creates some story problems too, which I'll get to later. So DC isn't showing any patience, in total contrast to Marvel, which has shown a lot of patience. So the only real silver lining here is that my expectations are so low that it's going to be difficult to disappoint me. And you know what? I was disappointed. And what's funny, though, is that I was very disappointed for very unconventional reasons. I didn't think this movie sucked. I actually thought that at the absolute least, it was on par with Man of Steel. I probably even like it a little more than that. But the reason why Batman vs. Superman let me down, despite my no expectations, was I saw flashes of greatness here and there. I liked certain aspects of this movie so much that it ended up pissing me off that this film didn't nurture those aspects, that it didn't follow through with them. And the main problem with Batman vs. Superman is it's more interested in setting up the Justice League movie than it is in telling its own story. So this constricts the narrative and allows all of its better ideas to suffocate under that pressure. So what did I like? Well, for one, I loved Ben Affleck as Batman. In fact, this is arguably my favorite interpretation of this character. Now, I do not read comic books, so I do not know if it's an accurate representation of the character, and quite frankly, I don't care. But I thought Ben Affleck did a great job at, you know, being charming and likable as Bruce Wayne, while at the same time, he always seems like he's on the brink of insanity. Like, one false move and he can become a villain. And I like that internal conflict they had going on there. And, you know, I liked how it strongly implied that the death of Robin at the hands of the Joker is fueling his current mean streak. He's not just kicking the shit out of criminals, he's branding them. And it's pretty outright stated that those with the Batman brand are pretty much beaten to death in prison. So I like the darker and edgier approach, even if it's not faithful to the comic books. And I like the moral ambiguity of this character because it makes Batman more nuanced and interesting, in my opinion. I also have to give credit to Zack Snyder for using visual storytelling to imply the fate of Robin without outright showing us or explaining it to us. I wasn't aware that Zack Snyder was capable of such subtlety. But this does lead to the problem because when this happens, when you see Batman walking through the Bat Lair and he comes across Robin's suit, which has been defaced by the Joker, it was kind of distracting because I really wanted to see what went down between Joker and Robin. I was curious, and that kind of upstaged the movie for me. It upstaged the current storyline. So even while we're seeing, you know, this other stuff go on between Batman and Superman, I'm still thinking about the implications of Robin's death. And this is why they really needed a standalone Batman story to show us what occurred, so therefore I'm not curious, while at the same time they could still show that exact same visual and the emotional impact would still be there. And depending on the circumstances surrounding his death, it could have even been magnified. So that's just another example as to why they jumped the gun in pairing Batman and Superman together. I also liked some of what they did with Superman's character. I liked seeing his feathers get ruffled because he makes some devastating mistakes here, showing that even though he's a superpowered alien, he's not God. And I thought the movie actually put him in certain positions of vulnerability that we've never really seen Superman in before, at least in the previous films, where Lex Luthor brings him to his knees without the use of kryptonite. And seeing Superman so enraged and scared, and that made him more relatable to me, and amplified the suspense because Superman at this moment doesn't seem all powerful. But because they're trying to balance Batman and Superman's individual stories, there's just not enough time to flesh any of it out. And they don't even share the screen together that often, so you're pretty much watching two different films unfold. I'm going to piss off a lot of people by saying this, but I actually liked Lex Luthor in this film. Now, yeah, it is just a typical Jesse Eisenberg performance, the twitchy, socially awkward, eccentric genius, a bit more menacing than usual. I thought he was pretty convincing when he was trying to be kind of intimidating. But I don't think that that is how the character of Lex Luthor is supposed to be, at least how a lot of what other people are saying. And he's totally different from the Gene Hackman and Kevin Spacey interpretations. However, the reason why I liked him is even though I enjoyed Gene Hackman and Kevin Spacey, they were much more hammy to the point of just, you couldn't hate them. They were so fun to watch, even when they were threatening the lives of people. They're just too charming, too charismatic, and you just want to see them banter with Superman a lot more. But this version of Lex Luthor is very twisted, very sinister. He is willing to do some fucked up shit, and it makes you hate the character, which I think is a refreshing change of pace. I've gotten kind of bored of Lex Luthor anyway because he's in so many of these Superman films, and so the fact that they have a very different version of him was cool to me. Now, a lot of people disagree with me there, and I totally respect that. That's merely my opinion. Wonder Woman was completely unnecessary. I think the reason why she's here is because they're afraid to do a Wonder Woman movie, considering how we're so used to Linda Carter in that role, and the last attempt to do a Wonder Woman TV show failed miserably. So they want to get some buzz surrounding her before they make that commitment. But she doesn't really add anything to the narrative. They could have easily edited her out entirely. And other than the final battle, the story wouldn't have changed at all. And she's not a major character, but she isn't enough to where it does stretch out the running time a bit longer than it needed to be. Okay, this is where the film pissed me off, is that stupid-ass hallucination sequence where Batman has a prophecy about this apocalyptic future where Superman has turned evil, and it's designed to foreshadow the main villain of the Justice League, some guy, I think he's called Darkseid. Fine, but it comes out of nowhere, is never really referenced again, so it felt to me like they had maybe filmed this in post-production and forced it in place of one of Batman's normal nightmare sequences. But it was confusing because it's presented in a way to show that somebody might be manipulating Batman into facing Superman, because somebody's yelling, "You were right about him. Lois Lane is the key." So you're wondering, Batman is going to do something that gets Lois Lane killed, I guess. But then she never plays into the third act at all. I mean, she kind of does, but it's kind of an afterthought. And I found out later on that that was supposed to be the Flash. Now, all I know about the Flash is he moves very quickly. Apparently, he has the power to move through time and project those images into other people's minds. What the fuck? This is why they needed a Flash movie going into this, to where they could set up that this guy has these powers. The action scenes were good, the special effects were good, but nothing really stood out as particularly great. I thought Man of Steel had better action scenes and better special effects, although this film, I'd say, is better paced. The fight between Batman and Superman, cool stuff. I liked how they used strategy, but it's already dissipating from my memory. The Doomsday battle, you know, also pretty well done, except I was disappointed that there was not more teamwork. It pretty much is Superman charges Doomsday, they struggle for a bit, Doomsday knocks him back. Wonder Woman charges Doomsday, they struggle a bit, Doomsday knocks her back. Batman charges Doomsday, they struggle a bit, Doomsday knocks him back. So it got kind of redundant after a while, but I would have been much more interesting seeing all three of them strategize together and work together. And in the end, I really don't think Batman or Wonder Woman was necessary for Superman to defeat Doomsday. And that pisses me off more than anything, since the whole point of the Justice League is them uniting to repel these greater threats. And what great way to set that up by having them unite together, and their teamwork is what wins the day. But nope, Superman could have pretty much done it all on his own. But still, the music's great. The soundtrack was awesome. One memorable track after another memorable track. I'll probably buy the CD. I've been listening to it on YouTube for the past few days, so that was cool. So should I recommend it? If you want, it's not good or bad enough to change your mind either way. I just thought it was kind of okay, but considering it teased me with so much greatness, I ended up feeling let down. And because this film just seems like it's merely a big marketing campaign for a future film. So I have to say, so follow me on Facebook, Twitter, read my reviews of The Howling. I hope you enjoyed this video, and I shall see you guys later.